Hey guys, Dillon Loomis here. Today's episode will be a little bit different, not as much editing, but I wanted to spend more time on the research and information and being able to present it to you guys clearly and concisely. In addition to that, this will be part one of two. So if you're new, make sure to subscribe to the channel and hit the bell so you're notified about part two of this series. But without further ado, let's get into it. Researchers at Chalmers University of Technology in Gothenburg, Sweden have discovered an interlayer made of spreadable, butter-like material that helps to improve the current energy densities tenfold that is said to also increase safety. It should be noted, researchers at Xi'an Xiaotong in China were also involved in the study. The interlayer makes the battery cell more stable, allowing it to withstand much higher energy densities. Probably most importantly from this research is the fact that this material, which I'll cover shortly, is very easy to apply onto the lithium metal anode in the battery, much like spreading butter on a sandwich. These new advancements were recently presented in the scientific journal Advanced Functional Materials. As most of you know, solid-state batteries could revolutionize the world of electric vehicles. A simple analogy would be to think of a solid-state battery like a dry sandwich. A layer of metal lithium acts as a slice of bread, and a ceramic substance is laid on top like a filling. This hard substance is the solid electrolyte as opposed to a liquid in a lithium-ion battery. This is what helps to transport lithium ions between the electrodes of the battery during charge and discharge, but because the sandwich is so dry, it's difficult to keep together, and there are compatibility issues between the bread and the topping. The material used in the latest research is soft and spreadable, made of nanoparticles of the ceramic electrolyte LAGP, which is then mixed with an ionic liquid. Don't worry, we'll break this down shortly. The liquid encapsulates the LAGP particles and makes the interlayer soft and protective. This material fills several functions and is spread very easily. To help us all understand this material better, nanoparticles are just particles that measure between 1 and 100 nanometers in diameter. They often possess physical properties like uniformity, conductance, or special optical properties that make them desirable in the world of scientific research. Nanoparticles have been used in the manufacture of scratch-proof eyeglasses, crack-resistant paint, stain-repellent fabrics, and ceramic coatings for solar cells. Essentially, they can contribute to stronger, lighter, cleaner, and smarter surfaces and systems. Now for LAGP, which is a Nascon-type phosphate glass ceramic and has been a commonly studied solid electrolyte material. Nascon is simply a sodium, superionic conductor. If you see Nascon, just know it's a crystalline solid that has a high conductivity of ions that rivals those of the liquid electrolytes. They have been applied to date mainly as the solid electrolyte in a sodium ion battery, as some exhibit low thermal expansion, which has been an issue in the world of solid state batteries. LAGP is short for lithium, aluminum, germanium, phosphorus, and oxygen. But often, phosphorus and oxygen are combined and referred to as simply phosphate. Historically, the issue has typically been chemical and thermal instability with lithium, which has limited attempts to use lithium as the anode material. With this advancement, a tailored, multifunctional interlayer between the solid electrolyte and lithium anode can address these interfacial issues. The interlayer is designed by creating a quasi-solid state paste in which the functionalities of LAGP and the ionic liquid, denoted as IL, are combined. In a solid state cell, the LAGP-IL separates the lithium from the LAGP, which creates a chemically stable interface with low resistance, and it prevents thermal runaway at elevated temperatures. Solid-state cells designed with the interlayer can be operated at higher energy densities while maintaining high levels of safety. In part 2 of this series, I'll get into more of a discussion of the selection of the ionic liquid electrolyte that is used in this research, as well as a conclusion and wrap-up of what this research means for real-world application. Be sure to subscribe so as to not miss part two. If you'd like to support the work I do here, please consider becoming a producer on Patreon in the episode description below. I'll see you guys in the next one.